Vanoggend het ek die voorreg om te preek oor nuut. Hoekom sê ek voorreg? Want ek het 'n oortuiging. I really have the sense this morning that we have people sitting here that is in a pit in this moment. So I want just for a moment say, if you sit in a pit and you feel there's no way out, you see this darkness surrounding you, and you're experiencing distance, not closeness. You've experienced that God is far away, He's not close to you in this moment, know that this sermon is for you. Maar ek wil net sê die res van ons wat miskien nie daar is, is nie uitgesluit nie. Van hierdie boodskap vir my is een van daai boodskappe wat ek beleef dat die Here met almal praat. Ek het al baie keer gepreek, dan weet ek ek praat met 2 of 3 ouens wat hier sit. Dan die ander ouens voel hulle is uitgesorteer, maar hierdie is een van daai boodskappe wat ek 'n oortuiging het dat die Here met almal van ons wil praat rondom waarmee jy besig is oor die gedagte van nuut. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with the whole idea of something new. So here's the fact. Who gets excited when you hear of something new that would be coming? Wie raak opgewonde as jy hoor iets is nuuts? Okay, hou julle hande gehou. Hou almal hande op. Nou gaan ons gou die hande sak. When you hear there's a new way to pay tax, who's excited? Okay, there's a few people. Okay, we will pray for you afterwards. When you hear there's a new law on how you should do stuff, who gets excited? Okay, nobody. Oh, well, Anthony. I can hate your reels. I leer elke dag nuwe reels hierso. You see, that's the thing that we get excited about if we speak about new. It should have a contribution to our lives and make our lives better, not worse. There should be less of an effort and it should make your life easier. Dit moet jou lewe makliker maak. As jy praat van nuwe tegnologie, as jy jou rekenaar aansit, ek weet nie van wie het al ooit hierdie volgende stelling gemaak nie. As ek 'n nuwe rekenaar, dan sê tegnologie is veronderstel my lewe makliker te maak. En dan doen dit nie. It takes a half an hour to boot up. It takes a half an hour for your phone to work. Tia's phone currently switches off after every message that she sends. So if you try to contact her and she's not getting back, it's not because something happened and she doesn't, you know, want to speak to you. It's just her phone is really, it's done. It's finished. Kaput. It's up. And she can only upgrade by October. So it's going to be a while before we would have a different phone. So, maar jy sê ding, as ek vir jou vanoggend sê nuut, jy gaan 'n nuwe kar kry. You're going to get a new car, a new home. Steek jou hand op, wie's opgewonde? All right. If I tell you you're going to have a new life, it's brand new. Everything is new. It's just great. It's amazing. You're going to be excited. Ek raak opgewonde oor die nuwe dieete, maar pas dit my toe nie. So ek gister op die skaal geklim, toe besef ek, oeps. Here's the thing about new. If we only get excited if it really would benefit us. As soon as it's, if we say we have something new, but it doesn't benefit us, we don't get excited. And a lot of times you look at the word of God and at the promises He's made, and we look at it like He's promising something new, but it's like paying a new type of tax. You're not excited about that. En die rede hoekom ons so daarna kyk is omdat ons het hierdie idee van God se beloftes en wat hy vir ons wil doen versus wat ons nou sien en dink ons God se beloftes is soos 'n nuwe belasting, want nou moet ek meer betaal vir minder. Moet minder in my sak kry. Vier of ander het ons vasgeval in hierdie ding van when God promises, we got caught into this thing that says if God says I have something new for you, it's not really beneficial to me. And this morning I really want to change that mindset. That I want you to get excited. And as we were praying this morning, we were speaking about God's doing a new thing, and Yaku actually made this picture of and it's not something I really have not seen. So I have to show it to you according to word that Yaku said. But he spoke about what's a volstruis in English? Ostrich. Ah, thank you. A ostrich maniki. Male, there you go. Ostrich male, if he gets excited. Now, you know, I haven't seen this, so I'm going to have to show you without really knowing. But he gets excited, he goes like this with his flarkies. He's, all right, and he gets excited, he picks up his legs, and it's a graag, Jaku. Okay, it goes like this. When stuff happens and an ostrich gets excited, He's really extravagant in his way he shows it. And we spoke about the fox as well. If a fox gets excited, you know, they chunk. Now, I know one part that's also true is as wild dogs. But while we're using ostriches and foxes, we'll be clear in a second. Wild dogs as well. If they get excited, they chunk and it is gelak and is it te kere gaan. When I saw iets gebeur, is opgewonden oor iets. If we speak about God's doing something new, it's something to get excited about. Listen quickly. It's something to get excited about. And maybe you're sitting here this morning and you are sitting in this pit and you don't see any way out. Jy sien nie daar 'n manier uit nie. Jy sien nie die plan wat die Here vir jou het is 'n goeie plan nie. Wil ek vir jou vanoggend sê, raak opgewonde van God doen iets nuuts. Hoor gou-gou Jesaja 43 vers 18 en 19. Ek sê nou vanoggend vir die ouens, my PowerPoint in my lewe was nog nooit so, ek het die woord kitsch gebruik, maar vergewe my. So, maar daar's nuut, want ek kon net, dis al wat ek kon kry om hierdie beginsel vas te maak. Hoor gou hierso. Jesaja 43 vers 18 tot 19 sê, vergeet al die dinge wat in die verlede gebeur het. Forget the things of past. Dis niks in vergelyking met wat ek nou gaan doen nie. Jesus ouens, dis 'n amazing belofte. Hoor gou. Everything that you got that was new, that got you excited, God wants you to do even better than that. He says not only to forget the worst part of your life, he also tells you to forget that the successes, the stuff that you've done that got you excited. He says, forget those things because what he has in store for you is even more than what you have experienced up to date. Vergeet hierdie goed. Ek lees dit weer. Vergeet al die dinge wat in die verlede gebeur het. Dis niks in vergelyking met wat ek nou gaan doen. Jesaja 43 vers 18 tot 19. Merk jou Bybel, merk jou foon, moet asseblief net nie 'n highlighter gebruik op jou foon nie, dit werk nie. Maar maak 'n nota. Vers 19 sê ek gaan iets nuuts doen. Ek gaan iets nuuts doen. En hy maak 'n stelling. En sê hy, dit het al reeds begin gebeur. Dan vra hy, sien julle dit nie? Ek maak 'n pad deur die woestyn vir my volk om huis toe te kom. Ek maak vir hulle riviere in die woestyn. Die Here kom doen iets nuuts in jou lewe. En hy vra vir jou vanoggend, sien jy dit nie? En ek wil vanoggend met jou gesels oor hierdie gedagte van iets nuuts. Die Here het 'n goeie plan vir jou. Hy dink net goeie planne oor jou. Hy droom net goeie drome oor jou. Hy wil net vir jou die beste gee. Now, I'm a dad. I have a son that's 6. My daughter is turning 8 in a week and two's time. And I only want to give them the best things. I want to make sure that their future would be better than mine. Not that my past was bad and growing up was bad, but I want to give them something better. I mean, every father and mother sitting here wants to give their children the best they can to make sure that their future would be full of hope and full of surprises even. En dit is ons begeertes pa, en ek lees dit hier, van ons hemelse vader, ons Abba vader, wat iets niets wil doen vir jou en vir my, een toekomst ons gee, Jeremia 29 vers 11, vol hoop en drome. My vraag vir oggend is, sien jy dit nie? Nou ek wil begin by die begin, om te verstaan wat beteken hierdie niet. Want ek het die oortuiging, dat baie keer verstaan ons nie wat hierdie niet is nie. Vir een of ander rede, dink ons, die Here het 'n halwe werk gedoen aan die kruis. En jy sit miskien sê, nee, Jacques, ek weet precies wat die Here gedoen het. Maar kom, ek vraag jou vir jou vraag. Het jy geweet, jy's 'n nuwe mens in Christus? En dan kan jy sê, die lei die klokkie in die kop, maar die hart sê dit nog nie. Nee, dit is ons baie keer voel. So hierdie skrifversie is al gelees, ons het al gehoor, maar my hart sê dit nog nie. My emosies sê dit nog nie. Hy wil vir jou vanoggend 'n verklaring maak. Die nuut wat die Here vir ons doen, begin by die ontdekking wie jy in Christus Jesus is. Hoor wat sê, oepsie, nou gaan my foon op by oomblik af. Hoor wat sê 2 Korintiërs 5 vers 17. Hy sê, daarom, iemand wat aan Christus verbind is, kwalifikasie. Jy het tot bekering gekom. Jy het jou lewe oorgegee. Jy het gesê, Here, ek kan nie meer hierdie lewe leef nie. U moet kom heers. Rihanna het so goed gesê in die aanbidding waar hy gesê het, Here, ons nooi u in om in elke aspek van my lewe te kom heers. Daai persoon is 'n nuwe skepping. Hoor gou skepping. Die Here het ons nie nuut gemaak nie. Weet jy wat beteken gemaak? Dit beteken jy het iets gevat en het iets daaruit gemaak. Sy sê ek het 'n tafel gemaak, was daar 'n boom gewees wat jy gesny het en 'n tafel gemaak. Die Here sê jy's 'n nuwe skepping. Dit beteken uit niks. Skepping beteken daar was niks. Hy het nie die oud nuut gemaak nie. Hy het jou herskep. Hy het jou oorgemaak uit niks uit. Het hy jou lewe in jou kom blaas. Jy's 'n nuwe skepping. Hy sê die ou dinge is verby. Kyk, die nuwe is hier. Vir my en vir jou om hierdie nuut wat die Here vir ons doen, the new thing that God wants to do for us to receive it and to experience it, we need to understand that we are new beings in Christ. He has made us new. And then he says, look, the old has passed away. There is nothing left of the old. So if you think that there's a black dog and a white dog in your life, and the one that gets the most kos, food, that one would be the stronger one. Dis wat ons glo. Ons glo dat daar 'n wit en 'n swart hond in ons lewe. Jy ken nie daai storie? Jy sê die een wat die meeste kos gee, daai een gaan heers in jou lewe. So as jy vir die sonde die hele tyd kos gee, dan gaan die sonde en die ou mens heers. En as jy vir die wit hond wat nou die nuwe mens is, die hele tyd kos gee, gaan daai heers. Maar kan ek vir jou gou sê, I want to make a proclamation this morning. If Christ said the old has passed, the black dog is dead. It's gone. It's not there anymore. That dog has died with Christ on the cross. And it's only the white dog remaining. So now your question might be, so what about my sinful nature and in essence? And then I want to say, if Christ has made you new, therefore you are no more longer classified or identity-wise a sinner. Your identity is not sin anymore. Your identity, jou identiteit, is kind van God, child of God. That would be your new identity. Do you still sin? Yes. But your identity has changed from an old, sinful, lustful being to a new being in Christ, His Son, His daughter. The old has passed away. And Neil T. Anderson, in all his books, he states that we now are saints who sometimes sin. And the best expression would be in Corinthians, where we would read in the beginning. Now, if you know the book of Corinthians, you know that these guys were doing all the wrong stuff. You know, from temple prostitution to whatever. But Paul starts his letter saying, I'm writing to the saints of Corinthians. Daai ouens wat al hierdie dinge aanvang. Vir hulle, kyk as ek nou die brief geskryf het, gesê ek gaan vir al die stouters. Maar Paulus skryf vir al die geheiligdes in Korintiërs. So die verstaan van wie ek is. Ja, ek het nog dinge wat ek doen, maar wie ek is in Christus. The identity is very important for us to receive the new. Because if you still believe you are a sinner in identity, then you will never believe that God wants to give you new. Why? Because you feel that you do not deserve it. You feel you cannot get it. Why? Because you feel like a stiefkind. What's it in English? A stepchild. And what I mean by that, a stepchild, is one who's not loved, one who has to perform to receive love. You feel like a weeskind. What's that in English? Orphan. That's the right one that I was looking for. The orphan. You feel like an orphan. And if you understand that God has adopted you, He's taken you as His own. Christ being our prototype. And they say identity change. You are new. Brand spanking new. Nothing that you have done in your history would determine your identity. God speaks over your life. And may I make this declaration this morning, that if God says something, who am I or who are you to put that in twyfel? Help me. Doubt. So I'm getting there. I'm working. The other day, we were speaking about everything that's happening in the Doctor Day in a family gathering of leaders in Pretoria. And the one guy said, okay, now is my English up. So it's almost there. He said, my English is up now. So, right. So here's the thing is that if God declared, who are we to doubt it? God made a declaration. He said, you are a new being. And this is what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5. Verse 17, you see, and ek sê dit nou Afrikaans, daarom iemand wat in Christus verbind is, is 'n nuwe skepping. You've been reborn, remade. You are new in Christ. Your identity has changed. You're no longer a slave to sin. You're no longer a slave to your circumstances, to your emotions, but you are new in Christ Jesus. Now, if you understand that, then there's six things that I want to mention this morning for you to receive the new in your life. Listen, I want you to get excited about what God's going to do, because He's going to do great things. And Joshua, when he spoke to God before they took the promised land, God said, you know, watch out, I'm going to do spectacular, amazing things amongst you. And I want to make that same declaration in your life today. Watch out for what God's going to do. You'll be surprised. If you understand that you are His child and therefore He will do this to you and for you, then you can start to expect, and God move in your expectation. And if you expect, the sky is the limit. I just want to also say, here's the problem we a lot of times we have. We limit, ons beperk, dit wat die Here in ons lewens kan doen. Hoekom? Van ons dink, ek is nie goed genoeg nie. Alle redes. I think about Moses standing in front of God in a burning bush. I mean, the living God is in front of him, and he says, I cannot speak. You know, God can touch his mouth so that he can speak, but we limit ourselves in what God wants to do because we say we cannot. If God said it over your life, it will become a reality. You need to understand a few things. So how do I receive the new? Hoe ontvang ek die nuwe? Hoor gou, Romeine 12 vers 2. Ek wil daarmee begin. Die belangrikste ding is, as ek weet, if God said something and I do not confess it over my life, I won't start believing it. I will not. Ek sal nie iets glo as ek nie dit oor myself confess. Al voel dit nie waar nie. Julle ken nou die storie van gevoel, nê? Ek voel nie nou lus nie, daarom drink ek dit nie. Dit is 'n baie slegte ding. Want imagine jy het nie lus gevoel om asem te haal nie. Imagine het jy lus gevoel om te bad nie. Ek van ons in die winter voel so, ek weet dit, maar asseblief. Luister gou hierso. Verander hoe jy dink deur om te bely wie jy is. If God said that you are a new being, if He said that you are new in Christ, if He made you new and He declares it over your life, start to confess it over your life. So when you do the wrong stuff, wanneer jy in 'n oomblik kom waar jy droog maak, in plaas om te sê, oh, ek kan nie glo ek het dit gedoen nie, ek sê, idiot, ek is hierdie sondige vieslike mens, sê jy, Here, ek is jammer, maar ek weet dis wie ek is. Van iets my niet gemaak. Hierdie, wat ek nou gedoen het, is nie my identiteit, is iets wat ek nou gedoen het, ja, maar dis wie ek is nie. I'm a new being in Christ, He's made me new, therefore I can say, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Father, for making me free from sin, and making me a slave of you. Which means He's my God who reigns in my life. Hy regeer. Romeine 12 vers 2 sê dit so, moenie julle leefstyl aanpas by die gedragspatrone van hierdie wêreld nie. Hoekom sê hy, moet nie, don't be conformed to the patterns of this world. Why would he say that? Because when we confess that this is how I am, this is who I am, you start to live that way. That's that sermon series that Rian's going to start in the next quarter, Parallel Universe. It's the idea that we confess things we say, but actually God confess something else over your life. And if you start to confess that, what God confesses over your life, you start to live in a parallel universe. Everybody would think you're crazy because you think that you speak a different way, you confess different things, and people say you're living in a parallel universe. Moenie julle leefstyl aanpas by gedragspatrone van hierdie wêreld nie, maar laat God julle omvorm deurdat hy julle denkpatroon vernuwe. Daai woord omvorm is 'n baie mooi Afrikaanse woord. Dit beteken mold. God wants to mold the way you think, by the way you confess things, the truths in his word, the truth that you're a new being, you set free from sin, you set free from the sinful nature, you are bound to Christ. Yes, the implication would be that he's your ruler. You cannot just live the way you want, but you're bound to Christ, but he's made you free. You can confess in a moment of weakness, say, this is not who I am. I am a new being in Christ. Let me tell you, the way to get victory over sin and over wrong habits would to confess the truth over your life, not the fact that you have made a mistake. When you confess the whole time that I'm too weak, let's be honest, you'll never do it. Ek het probeer ophou rook. Ek onthou dit baie goed. Ek het so 90 sigarette 'n dag gerook. Ja, is nogal 'n paar bakkies 30. En ek onthou baie goed hoe ek probeer ophou rook het. I really tried to stop smoking. I tried my best, my utmost best. And every time when I lit up a cigarette, I would say, oh goodness, I don't have the power. And, you know, I'm a smoker. You know, maybe I must just keep on smoking. This is who I am. And every time I tried my best, but you know what? When I quit, the final time I quit, since then I've never had a problem. What happened is that I realized that I'm not qualified, or my identity is not smoker. Ek's nie, die identiteit is nie, ek is 'n roker nie. Dis iets wat ek doen. Ek rook. Nie, ek is 'n roker. En toe ek dit begin besef, toe besef ek, dit beteken as die Here my nuut gemaak het, kan ek ophou rook? Ja, hoekom? Because my identity has changed from being a smoker to somebody who sometimes smoke. Wat net gou die logika. So I stood up there one morning and ek het op 'n stap toer gegaan, so dit het ook gehelp. Daar was 'n paar ander wat gerook het, maar ons het nogal ver geloop, so dit is nogal moeilik om te rook en te loop. Dit was 'n interessante belewenis. Maar here's the thing, that morning when I stood up and I put out my last cigarettes, and I did smoke 90 cigarettes a day, that last one, I said, this is not who I am anymore. I'm now a new being in Christ. He's released me from this. I'm a slave of Christ, not a slave of anything else. And when I started to confess, every time I felt the urge to smoke, I said, this is not who I am. And within a week, I stopped smoking. Last cigarette put out 1996, never smoked again. And that's the thing. If you start to confess what God says over your life, your thinking pattern, the way you think about stuff, the way you perceive stuff, that changes completely. So wat ek sê, verander hoe jy dink deur om te bely wie jy is. Start to confess who you are in Christ and see your life changes. So that's the first thing, to receive your promises, to see how God opens up new things for your life. The second thing would be, weet dat jy heers oor jou emosies en omstandighede. Know that you can rule over your emotions. So many young people today they are led by their emotions. Jy sien, ek het geleer, ek gaan my Engelse tenses vanoggend reg kry. They are led by their emotions. So they have a need to date somebody or to go to what something, and they do not know Christ in that moment. They just feel, this is what I need, this is what I want. And then they are actually led away from Christ by that. We're not led by our emotions. Ons emosies moet nie nommer 1 wees nie. Ouens, hoor gou. Of jy sê, ons emosies kan nie eers een weerste wees nie. Jy weet wat is die grootste probleem wat ons het? Is wanneer jy iets sien, jy sien iets gebeur. Jy voel kwaad. As jy kwaad voel, begin jy dink, hoekom het dit gebeur? Dan begin jy aannames maak. Is dit net ek? Was net ek. Sorry. So okay. Dis nou iets wat ek doen, ekskuus julle. Kom ek verduidelik vir julle hoe werk dit. Ek sien Tia doen iets. Ek word kwaad vir Tia, dan begin ek sommer sê, sy doen dit omdat sy dit wil doen, en sy gaan vir my wys. Nou die dag toe het ek en sy 'n bietjie woordewisseling, en sy kom haal my met die bakkie, sy's laat, sy's 15 minute laat. Nou iemand wat my goed ken, is laat werkie vir my. Daar's ek my kop klats uit. Dit is soos nee. So nou is ek kwaad vir haar, ek sê luister, jy's laat. 15 minute. En ons ry gou gym toe, om nie te gaan gym nie, om net ons kaarte te swat. Okay. So ons ry gaan gym toe, Matia ry met die bakkie nê. Ek meen sy ry. En sy gaan om die een draai en sy sê ek sê vir wat maak jy? Sê ek is haastig. En ek begin kwaad raak. Ek sê man, jy sit my lewe in gevaar. Wat maak jy? En ek begin sommer in hierdie ding wanneer ek raak kwaad en ek laat my emosies my lei en ek sê vir haar so 'n paar dinge. En ek sê vir luister jy, jy sit my lewe in gevaar. Wat dink jy doen jy? En Tia sê vat dit nogal baie goed tot op 'n stadium. Maar agwel, so hier is die punt is dat baie keer dat ons emosies ons lei in die oomblik, dan sê ons goed wat ons nie eers gedink het. We don't think about what we're doing because emotions get so important to us that we think that's what we base our decisions on. Unfortunately, emotions is just a feel-good experience. So if you feel bad, you do something so you feel better. You don't do the right things. You don't choose the right things. Emotions. What Christ has done, he said we can rule over our emotions in his omstandighede. So, situations. Romeine 5 vers 17 sê, die oortreding van hierdie een mens, dis Adam, het veroorsaak dat die dood oor ons regeer, maar deur die een mens, Jesus Christus, hoor gaan hierdie konsep, word vir ons nog veel meer gegee. Ek wens ek het baie tyd gehad. Want as ek hierdie veel meer beginsel kon vasmaak, en dit wat die Here vir jou beplan, veel meer in Christus. Dit is, as jy gaan lees 'n bietjie deur die ou, die Nuwe Testament, dan gaan sien jy hoeveel keer daai veel meer konsep deurkom. En dan is dit altyd 'n bo op ingedruk, meer as wat ek kan verwag, belofte wat die Here vir jou gee. So veel meer gegee. Almal wat God se oorvloedige genade geskenk van vryspraak ontvang, sal koninklik oor die sonde en die dood triomfeer. Wat het sonde in die lewe gebring? Sonde, toe Adam en Eva val, het emosies belangriker geraak as God. Hoekom? Want daar's drie realiteite wat ek en jy het. 'N Eksterne realiteit, dinge wat rondom ons gebeur. External reality, 'n internal reality, how I feel, en 'n ewigheidsrealiteit, eternal reality. And when sin came, one of those three fell away, and that was eternal reality. Eternal reality was the biggest reality that Adam and Eve had before the fall of sin. And after that, emotions and what happens around us became more important than God. So what I'm saying is, when you know Christ, you have an eternal reality that you can build your world on rather than your emotions and what happens with you. You can rule over those two things. Die derde een is, verander hoe jy praat oor die teleurstelling en pyn. Paulus gaan na Filippense toe. Filippians. And he ministered to them, and that's the, I think, one of the worst experiences he has of his life. A lot of bad stuff happens to him in that area, in that place. A lot of things that would make him negative. I mean, as jy nou na 'n plek toe gaan, en jy praat met mense, ons het al gaan kamp, dan gebeur alles wat sleg is daar. When everything happens, your son gets sick, you know, you get that rain and that rain in die tent and it's nat. When your son gets sick, he gets sick on the only mattress you have, and the only blankets you brought, and it's cold. I mean, it's like, it feels like minus 100. And then it's just an experience. And if you go back home, you remember all these bad things. And when somebody asks you about it, you don't say, yeah, it's dankbaar. He said, no, it's the worst camping experience ever. Everything, the camel almost bitten. All right. Almost bitten my arm off. I mean, it's just the worst experience ever. Now Paulus het so belewenis gehad in Filippense. Hoor gou wat skryf hy. Hy sê, Filippense 1 vers 3, hy sê, elke keer as ek aan julle dink, hierdie mense wat vir hom hel gegee het, dank ek God. Hoor gou die ander ding wat keer dat ons die nuut van die Here beleef is die manier hoe ons met teleurstellings en probleme hanteer. The thing that prevents us from receiving God's promises and the new that he wants to do in our lives is the way we speak about the stuff that disappoints us. If we are negative and we speak negativity all the time, guess what? That's all that we will know. We confess it over our lives. That's all that we would know. But if we can start to say, God, I'm looking for the good in this. I'm thankful that you are helping me to get through this. And you start to confess God's goodness within that situation. So as ek dit, as dit jy is, wat ek in die begin gepraat van, jy sit in hierdie put, en jy sien hierdie donker, en kan ek vir jou vra, daar's baie om dankbaar te wees, begin dit gebruik, want dis die strale van lig in jou put. Dis God se goedheid. En dit te bely oor jou lewe, hoe praat jy van jou teleurstellinge? Hoe kies jy om daai teleurstellinge te hanteer? Die vierde ene, ek gaan nou vinniger hardloop hierdeur, want daar's 'n belangrike gedeelte waarmee ek wil aan. So elke keer as ek aan julle dink, dis nou Filippense 3:14, elke keer as ek aan julle dink, dank ek God. So onthou dit, hoe jy jou teleurstelling hanteer en jou pyn is belangrik. Die vierde ene, ontvang die beloftes wat God vir jou gegee het en weet in Christus dat dit ja is. En amen, sê ons daarop. Hoor gou, how many of you sit here today and know that God has promised something in your life, but stuff in life happened that you have experienced stuff. You have experienced a lot of stuff that caused you to think that God has not given you those promises. Het jy al ooit beleef dat God sê vir jou iets, en dan gebeur soveel dinge, dink jy nee, ek het verkeerd gehoor? Ek wil vir jou sê, as die Here oor jou lewe iets gespreek het, sal dit so wees. Hoor gou, ek wil nie sê dit kan so wees nie, ek miskien nie. Dit sal so wees. Hier is die sleutel wel. Gaan jy dit ontvang of gaan jy wegdraai van dit? So moet jy dat jou omstandighede, ons het net gehoor, jy kan daaroor heer. Jou omstandighede, die realiteite wat jy nou face, vir jou sê dit gaan nooit so wees nie. It will. If God said it, it shall happen. Hoor gij so 2 Korintiërs 1:20 gesê, want al die baie beloftes van God in Christus Jesus is 'n volmondige ja. Daarom is dit ook deur Christus se toedoen dat ons om God te verheerlik daarop amen sê. So wat sê hierdie stukkie? Sê God beloof oor jou lewe om dit nie te ontvang, moet ek sê amen op dit. Want dit is al klaar ja in Christus. Everything that God promised is yes in Christ. Why? Because God wants to bless you as his son and his daughter. He wants to lead you through life. He wants to be with you. He wants you to reign with him in this life over sin and death. She's given you everything that you need. And if you can accept that, if you can realize I'm a new being in Christ, I'm accepted in Christ, therefore that this what God has promised over my life will happen. But the reality that I'm facing now, although that might be totally opposite of what God promised, that will happen. Because God's timing is just a bit different than ours. If you want to see the new in your life, accept His promises. As 2 Corinthians 1:20 says, the promises in Christ is yes and amen. We say, we accept it, yes, and we say amen on that. Tweede laaste punt van hoe ontvang jy jou beloftes of jou niets, is die Here wil met jou praat, glo dit. There's nothing worse than going through a period of time where you don't feel, or you feel you cannot hear God's voice. I don't know if you have experienced it. Ek weet nie of jy al beleef het, jy gaan deur 'n tyd waar jy nie die Here se stem kan hoor nie. Waar jy voel die Here is ver, en daar's soveel dinge wat gebeur en skree, maar jy sê asof jy teen hierdie muur vaslaat. En ek het al deur so iets gegaan, en ek praat met Tia, en sy sê, wag nie, is maklik, sit worship musiek aan, en dan gaan jy in die maar ek sit worship musiek en ek voel dit net nie. Ek voel dit nie, hoor net die woord wat ek gebruik. Ek voel dit net nie. En eendag sit ek so, en dit is so duidelik soos die Heilige Gees wat vir my sê, wat met my praat, en die oomblik waar ek glo, ek kan die Here se stem hoor nie, is wat's die waarheid? What is the truth of your life? The word promises that God will speak to you. And if you don't feel that you hear God's voice, it doesn't make it the truth. A feeling is something that can mislead you. You know the truth. The word says God wants to speak to you. It says in Isaiah 30:21, he says, en ek lees in Afrikaans, hy sê, jy sal 'n stem hoor sê, hier is die regte pad. Draai om en loop hier langs. Roughly translated to English, God will stand behind you and whisper in your ear which way to go. It's a promise. It's not a maybe. It's not if I'm a better person. Because in Christ you're already a new being, therefore He speaks to you the whole time. And we need to accept that promise and that truth of our lives. Ons moet dit aanvaar. Dis wat God sê. En weer as wat God het gesê het, dan is dit so. Sê vir oggend jy sit en jy beleef jy kan nie God se stem hoor nie. Moet ek vir jou vra, miskien kyk jy om God se stem te hoor op 'n manier wat jou nie natuurlik toekom nie. Sometimes we try to hear God's voice by an audible word or we pray, God, just send your prophet. Let your prophet come and speak over my life. Listen, most of the promise that God gave to me was given to me while I was praying through a scripture. Not somebody's coming up to me saying, Jacques, God says this and this and this and this. And it's interesting enough that those promises were confirmed later on, yes, but only after I started to believe them. It's interesting how God works with me, because He speaks to me through a piece of scripture, and then I go through a whole period of time where I doubt this promise. And then when I start to say, but God, you said it, this will happen. Then somebody comes and says, Jacques, God says this and this and this, and this will happen. But we turn it around. We say, God, send somebody to speak to us, then we will believe. God says, no, believe me. Believe Him. Believe His voice. And He'll speak to you through different ways, through people, through scripture, through a TV program, through a movie, through your children, through a flat tire on the highway. He can speak to you through any way. Something, you know, ek dink 'n fout wat ons maak is, dink ons moet gaan 'n uur in die kas sit met die deure toe om die Here se stem te hoor. You don't have to go in solitude to hear God's voice. There's different ways for different people. And you must understand that God wants to speak to you. You need to believe that truth to receive the new. And if you believe that truth, you will start to see how you hear God's voice clearly in your life. Ek moes sit nadat ek voel ek hoor nie sy stem nie, waar ek net vir 'n oomblik gaan sit en dink oor 'n belofte. Hierdie stukkie, Jesaja 30, het die Here vir my gee. Ek onthou baie goed hoe dit gewerk. Ek het vir my 'n oorbel deurgedruk. So I got an earring going. It was a Nike piercing. Thank you. Piercing. It was a Nike merk, daai regmerkie. Just do it. Okay? And I just did it. All right? So somebody took a copy spelt and they said make it extremely hot. Put an eraser at the back of your ear and just push it through. All right. So, it got infected and it was sore and red and swollen and it's not lekker. But I didn't take out the earring or the stud, because I was afraid it would close, so I kept it in there. It was a very painful experience in getting it in. I don't want to take it out to do it again. So I was standing there, and this guy comes up to me, and I did know Christ by that time already. And a guy came up to me. He says, "I have a word for you. God says you will hear His voice as clearly as you can hear people with your ears." And he touches me on the door. He grabs me, my earbell. And he has it. He says, God says you will hear His voice. And I go, ah, the whole time. And that stuck to me. It just got to me. And I said, but God said. So I was sitting in this period of time where I couldn't hear His voice. And I was sitting there and I said, God, I cannot hear Your voice. I don't feel You. And He says, I made a promise. Remember the pain. So every time I touch my ear, I remember, yes, you said. So that's what I would say. Confess it over your life. God said it will be, so it will be. The last point on how to receive the new is to get your priorities right. Sometimes our priorities would not be in line. Partykeer is ons prioriteite nie wat dit moet wees nie. En die Here sê kry jou prioriteite reg. Partykeer wil ons 'n bietjie shine kry, partykeer wil ons 'n bietjie glory hê, partykeer wil ons 'n applous hê. Ek hou nogal van 'n applous, weet, nie nou nie, later. Daai tipe goed, ons soek hierdie goed wat mense net dat is net goed kan voel oor homself. En ons mis dit dat die Here sê, doen dit vir sy koninkryk. Matteus 6 sê dit baie mooi. Hy sê, vers 33, nee, maak die koningsheerskappy van God en dit wat voor hom reg is, julle prioriteit. Die ander vertaling sê, His righteousness. Daar's 'n verstaan van we are His righteousness. So if you make His kingdom and His righteousness, the understanding of who we are, our priority, all the other things will fall in place. So to receive the new from God, we need to put our priorities into place. Can I ask you, and this is a difficult thing, let me ask you to determine where your priorities would be. Just think about where your time and your money is going. So wil weet wat is prioriteit in jou lewe? Kyk waar spandeer jy jou tyd en jou geld. Baie maklik. As dit vir jou prioriteit is, ek sê vir jou eendag te sit ons so gesels en sê ons wil in die kamp ding inkom. We want to go camping. We have to go camping where nobody else goes. So that's a priority in our lives. So every time we think about budget, we think about what we need to do this. And we put money there. So nou koop ons die goedjies wat ons nodig het om dit te maak werk. Want ons het dit vir ons 'n prioriteit gemaak. Where's your priority in life? The easiest way to see where your priority would be is where you spend your time and your money. Now, if you can quickly think about those two things in your life, and you ask the question, who is the most important person in your life in comparison to where you spend your time and your money, who would that person be? Would it be yourself? Maybe your children? Maybe your wife? But where does God fit in that picture and His kingdom? So for you to receive the new, you must understand that when He brings the new, it's not about you. Yes, it's for you, but it's not exclusively about you. Dit gaan nie net oor jou nie. Sy droom is meer as net om jou lewe beter te maak. Sy droom is deur wat hy vir jou doen, ander aan te raak. En dit sê ons in Jesaja 43, as jy daai hele stukkie gaan lees, vers 18 en 19 sê, vergeet al die dinge wat in die verlede gebeur het, dis niks in vergelijking met wat ek nou gaan doen, en ek wil nie daar klem lê op nou gaan doen, nou is 'n relatiewe begrip, tyd is mos 'n relatiewe begrip, die ouens wat science freaks is, verstaan daai konsep, tyd is 'n relatiewe begrip. Hier is die ding van tyd, is dat moet jy dink as die Here sê nou, gaan dit onmiddellik gebeur nie, maar jy gaan dit moet al begin confess, want when a new happens, you must be ready for it. Morgen sê, vergeet al die dinge wat die verlede gebeur het, dit is niks in vergelijking met wat ek nou gaan doen nie. Ek gaan iets niets doen, dit het al reeds begin gebeur. Sien julle dit nog nie? Sien die rede hoekom ons nie sien nie, is daar ses goeds in ons lewens nie, ons praat nie reg nie, ons bely nie reg oor ons lewens nie, ons het nie die regte prioriteite nie. Hy sê, ek maak 'n pad deur die woestyn vir my volk, om huis toe te kom, ek maak vir hulle rivier in die woestyn. So die Here doen iets niets in hulle lewens, hy bless hulle, hy geef hulle voorspoed, hy geef hulle guns, maar hoor wat is die gevolge van wat hy doen? Hy sê, die wilde diere sal dankbaar wees daaroor. Vers 20. Sê die Here, God is doing something in your life. And the people around you, even those who do not know Christ, will be glad and excited about what he's doing. Hy sê die jakkalse, onthou ek begin met jakkalse wat opgewonde is, en die volstruise, ek begin met dit, sal bly wees omdat ek vir hulle water in die woestyn gee. Can I ask you a question? To whom did God give water in a desert? In the first few verses. He didn't give it to the ostriches and the jackals. He gave it to his people. He gave it to you and me. Why? So that the ostriches and the jackals can be excited about God's provision. So when God provides in your life, when God's doing something new in your life, it's so that He can bless other people. When you have this new revelation of His Word, don't keep it to yourself. Speak to somebody. There's somebody that needs to hear this new revelation of Christ in your life. So when God creates a way for you to go forward, to move forward into a relationship with Him, or maybe He blessed your marriage. A lot of times we sit and we have amazing marriages, and we don't speak about this amazing things we've learned on how to. And you know what? It's one of those things that God gives you the wisdom to address an issue in your marriage, and then you can export it to other people's lives. You see how He has created this loving environment in your home, and He actually wants you to say, you know, speak to people about it. And a lot of times, you would speak to somebody who didn't ask you, but you speak in such a way that they feel, what? You you know, I hear what this guy is saying. There's some principles I can take into my life to get the marriage I wanted. I mean, you've looked at it. So veel ander areas. Hy sê, ek maak fontein in die woestijn, so dat my uitverkore volk hulle dors kan les. So the jackals and the ostriches would be excited. Why? Because God makes a way for you. He wants you to be blessed. He wants you to experience the new. He has made you a new being. You are a son and a daughter of Christ. Rian, jylle kan voor in te kom. So you are new in Christ. A new being. And don't let the devil, don't let the enemy come and steal from you because you think you are not worth it. Christ has determined you worthy. He has determined you worthy to receive all the promises of God. So just the six things again. So the first thing would be to renew your mind. Make sure that you start to confess over your life what God has promised, what God has said about who you are. Make those confessions. Don't look at your situation. Don't go about how you feel about your situation. Confess the truth from the Word of God over your life. Renew your mind. The second one would be that God has given you the right to rule over your emotions, over your situations. Yes, you would still would have bad things happen. Jy gaan nog steeds dinge hê wat sleg is, ja, maar God gee vir jou die manier en die krag om te heers bo oor dit. Dan gaan hy 'n situasie weer, jy dink ek kan nie oorheers nie. En dan sê jy vir jouself, "Duh, ek kan." Wie kyk NCIS? Kom Gibbs en klap vir die ou in die kop, Tony. So af en toe moet die Here dit met ons ook doen. Sê hy, "Jy kan heers. Jy kan heers oor hierdie goed." Die derde is change the way you speak about your pain and disappointments. Verander hoe jy praat oor jou teleurstellings. Want as jy hele praat van as soos 'n victim is, gaan jy 'n victim vir die res van jou lewe wees. Sy sê, dis maar dat jy sê al die slegte dinge gebeur met my. I remember a period of time in my life where I said, daar's so 'n ou gesegde wat sê, there's no rest for the wicked. Am I right? That's the right way to say it. All right. So I said, there's no rest for the weary. Because I felt weary. And I said, there's no rest for me. That's not true. I started to say things over my life because I was disappointed and I had pain and experiences. God says, change the way you speak about your pain and your disappointments. Start to look for the things you are, you can be thankful about. Kyk waarvoor kan jy dankbaar wees in 'n situasie. Weet jy, in die tye wat ek die diepste, die donkerste oomblikke gehad het, is daar dinge wat ek vandag kan sê, ek is dankbaar. Die Here het my nog altyd deurgedra. Inteendeel, daar's sekere slegte goed wat met my gebeur, waarvoor ek dankbaar is. Nie omdat dit seer gemaak en ek hou van seer nie, maar omdat dit my beter mens gemaak het. Omdat ek toegelaat die Here my daardeur dra. Verander hoe jy praat, nummer 3, oor hoe jy voel, wanneer jy deur slegte goed gaan, oor hoe jy oor jou slegte experiences praat. Nummer 4 is ontvang die beloftes van God. Just receive it. Don't stand against it. Don't think you'll never achieve it. Just say, God, if you said it, it will be. And there's so many people that started small things for God. And then, you know, it exploded. And we think, yes, God is just gracious to that guy. But it's not true. Some of us just do not accept the promises God gave us. And we're not running with it. Number 5, he said, just believe that God do speak to you. Even if you feel far away from God in this point of time, let me tell you, God is speaking to you now. He's speaking to you always. And the truth of the matter would be that if you just stop to listen in the way God made you to listen, then you will hear His voice. You will see His guidance. He'll be with you. And the last point would say that get your priorities right. Where should your priorities be? Number 1, God and His kingdom, and our understanding of our righteousness in His kingdom. As daai ses goed in plek is, gaan jy dit nie ontvang. Ek wil vra dat almal hulle oë toemaak, and I just want to ask that everybody closes their eyes, nobody looking around in this point of time. As I said, I started out with people, I have this experience of people sitting in this pit, and it seems that I cannot get out. I feel that I see this darkness all around them. It's as if the darkness has swallowed you. Asof jy ingesluk is deur die donkerte. jy sien nie 'n weg uit nie. Ek wil vanoggend saam met jou bid. As dit jy is. Vir jou vra as jy voel jy sit in hierdie put, jy kan nie uitkom. Wil jy net gou jou hand opsteek dat ek saam met jou kan bid? Dankie, ek sien jou hande. Ek sien jou hande, dankie. Ek wil vir jou vanoggend 'n verklaring oor jou lewe maak. As jy in daai put sit, daai 6 punte wat ek vir jou gesê het, jy kan by my preeknotas kom haal. Begin dit toepas in jou lewe. Begin sê die Here het meer vir my as wat ek nou beleef. Dit wat ek nou sien is tydelik. Dis actually 'n fraksie van 'n lewe. Maar dit wat die Here vir my beplan is 'n goeie en 'n genotvolle lewe. Hy het vir my lewe in lewe in oorvloed beleef of altyds beplan. He wants to give me life and love and life in abundance. Hier vanoggend jy sê, if you feel that I'm in this pit and I cannot get out, man, I've been there where I feel that there's no way out, and I just start to get quiet before God and say, God, I just confess this morning that although I feel I'm in a pit, I know that you are closer on this point of time in my life than I would ever would have thought that you would be. Here is so naby in hierdie oomblik aan my. Ek wil net jy moet dit net bely oor jou lewe. Just bely dit net. Sê Here, ek weet, dit voel nie so nie, maar jy's naby. Jy's hier in hierdie put saam met my. Here, ek bid vir die mense wat hulle hande opgesteek het vanoggend sê ek sit in hierdie put, Here. Ek sien eintlik Here, U wat staan by 'n huis. En hierdie knoppie gedruk vir opgaan uit die put uit. Die deure gaan oop en hou hierdie deure oop. Ek sien hoe hou hierdie deure oop. Ek sien hoe sit U hand op daai deure. En U nooi ons in hierdie huiser in hierdie huiser wat vol lig is. Glaspanele so jy kan lekker rondom sien. En ek sien hoe die Here mense innooi. Ek sien hoe die Here julle innooi in hierdie huiser om uit hierdie put uit te kom. Maar ek besef ook dit het te doen met jy wat moet in die huiser inklim. Wil jy miskien terwyl jy oortoe is, wil jy net gou-gou in jou geestes oog dit sien. Hoe Christus jou nooi in hierdie huiser. En hy sê, kom my kind, klim in, kom ons gaan uitkom. Ons gaan nie uitkom. Here, ek bid vir elkeen wat dit beleef volgens. Here, dat jy 'n restaurasie en herstel bring in hulle lewens. Here, dis nie deur ons woorde en oulike dade, dis deur U Heilige Gees. Dis U krag. Here, dis wat lekker is om te weet, I'm a new being in Christ. Because if I'm new, the fullness of the power of Christ lives within me. That power that caused Christ to be raised from the death, He now lives in me. And He will raise me up from this pit. I must just accept the truth that I'm a new being in Christ. Wil jy regtig nooi as jy hand opgesteek om jy vrees in hierdie put. Hoor gou, die Here staan by die huiser. Die deure is oop, klim in. Aan daai krag wat die Here wat vir Christus die dood het opgewek het lewe in jou. As 'n nuwe skepping in Christus. Miskien sit jy vanoggend hier en ek wil hiermee afsluit in hierdie gebed. Is dat miskien sit jy vanoggend hier en jy sê, Here, ek wil daai nuut ontvang. Maar daar's verskeie redes hoekom jy nog nie beleef het daar's iets nuut vir jou op pad. Verskeie redes van dinge wat jou aandag afgetrek het, omstandighede, finansies, wat ook al dit kon veroorsaak. As jy wil hê ek moet saam met jou bid, wil jy ook gou jou hand opsteek vir daai nuut wat die Here bring nie. As jy voel jy's nie excited nie, as jy voel jy kort excitement, you need to get excited about what God is going to do, the new He's bringing, and you want me to pray with you, just quickly put up your hand. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Sien jy aan dit oral opgaan. Here, ek bid vir oggend, Here, vir ons, Here, wat hierdie verwagting het van die nuwe. Here, dit is soos ek weet ek gaan 'n nuwe kar kry en ek is so excited, maar ek moet papierwerk doen en niemand hou van papierwerk. Here, ek besef dit is hoe ons nou voel, Here. Daar's hierdie nuut wat op pad is, maar ons is 'n bietjie besig met 'n paar goedjies wat ons aandag aftrek van die nuut. Here, ek bid, Here, U woord is volmaak. U woord sê in Jesaja, as U woord uitgestuur het, sal dit nie terugkeer voordat dit gedoen het wat sy purpose was. He will not, your word will not return if it has not completed its purpose. Your word is going out this morning over people's lives saying that look, I'm making everything new. Do you not see it yet? I pray, Father, that you would open up people's eyes, that they would see the new coming. That they would see this force of God coming to change everything. Father, let us not be afraid of the new. Let us not be concerned of stuff changing because we don't like change. Let us be excited about the new thing you're going to do, Father, because everything you're going to do in our lives that would make stuff new is so that we would have life and life in abundance. So I pray, Father, for everyone that says, I don't feel the new. There's so many things that's distracting me from new. Father, help us to see in perspective what you're doing. Maybe we just busy with the paperwork, with the admin, before the new come, before we receive that new. Father, let us keep faith in your promises. Let us keep on confessing those promises so that we can stand in victory with you, even though it doesn't seem that a promise, the new is here. Here, ek weet, ek so oortuig van mense wat niets nodig het in hun lewens nou. So Here, ek staan vanoggend. En ek wil net intree vir daai mense wat voel hulle het nie genoeg geloof nie. I'm just experienced people say, I don't have enough faith to see the new happening. Father, I thank you that your word is sharper than a two-edged sword that will cut through everything. Here, u swaard, u woord, sny nou deur mense se ongeloof. Here, u woord, soos ek nou praat, is besig om mense se harte geloof te aktiveer. U gee geloof. Dis iets wat ons moet hê nie. Here, ek bid, Vader, soos ek nou bid en my hande uitstrek oor hierdie gehoor, Here, bid ek dat u gees sal kom soos 'n golf en mense sal opkikker en wakker maak vir die beloftes wat u oor hulle lewens uitspreek, vir die nuut wat kom, die vrese en die bangheid en die goed wat in die pad staan uit die pad uit weggeruim word. Hierdie ek sien hierdie tsunami golf oor mense se lewens en hoe daai tsunami golf alles wegvat uit die pad uit vir dit wat kom. Ek sien in die na die golf hierdie beloftes, hierdie nuut van die Here inkom in jou lewe en ek wil jou vanoggend challenge, staat to believe God. Take him at his word. He said something new is coming. He didn't say someday. He said it's already happening. Don't you see it? Start to open up your eyes to see. Father, I pray that you open up each one's eyes, all of us, all of our eyes, Father, so that we can see the new coming, so that we can see the Spirit of God moving, not just in our lives, but in the people around our lives, Father, people around us, our family, our friends, those who need Christ. Father, let us start to see how your Spirit is moving in people's lives and bringing change. It's bringing salvation. It's bringing breakthrough. It's bringing restoration to relationships. Father, I thank you. This moment, you are working on a relationship between a mother and a son. Father, in this moment, you are restoring. You're working on the son's heart, not the mother. You're working on the son's heart, and you're changing the son's heart to be the son that you've made him to be for his mother. Thank you that I can speak life over that relationship now in the name of Jesus. And that I can declare your change is coming, the new is coming in that relationship. And that you are bringing healing. Healing in that relationship in Jesus' name. Dankie Here dat ek weet u werk in individue se harte op hierdie oomblik. U is besig met wonderwerke. Ek wil jou nooi terwyl ek net hierdie oomblik vasmaak in jou hart. Begin met 'n verwagting, ouens. Ek beleef hoe die Here net dinge in jou hart kom doen. Geniet. En ons gaan nou sing God You Reign. Ek wil hê jy moet dit verklaar hoe jy lewe, sê Here, U regeer, U woord regeer. En miskien is daar besig iets in jou hart te gebeur. Laat toe dat die Here dit klaar maak. Moet jy haastig voel. Moenie voel jy moet nou aanbeweeg nie. Ons is nog nie klaar nie. Ek wil sê, miskien is die Here besig met 'n wonderwerk in jou lewe. Genesing, fisies, emosioneel en verhouding. Verklaar dit. God, you reign. Soos ons het sing, over these circumstances. U heers oor hierdie donker pit. U heers oor die verhouding met my seun, met my dogter, met my man. U heers oor al hierdie goed.